I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I want to note that we had an executive session yesterday dealing with litigation and personnel. Are there any additions or corrections for the August 1st commissioner meeting minutes? There was no budget and ops meeting, so there's no minutes to approve there. Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Hearing none, we'll move to the agenda under authorizing budget department. Adopt a resolution authorizing 2019 budget transfers in the amount of $768,577 and 2019 appropriations in the amount of $2,056.
$2 million.
Yeah. We have an odd decimal there.
Yeah.
$2,056,000. Whatever.
Something over $2 million.
It's something over $2 million. Wherever you want to put the dot, I don't, who cares? Actually, we care. So get the dot in the right spot the next time.
$2,056,586.
This is what happens when you have the boss take over for somebody that actually knows what they're doing.
Well, except my assistant.
No, don't blame this on your assistant. Oh,
the buck stops there.
Oh, no. So, you know what? If we don't make mistakes in life, you're not doing anything. We all make them, so not a problem.
You're no Harry Truman, I can see that.
Human resources. Item one, authorize the appointment of Sabrina Gross to Senior Governmental Accountant, Office of the Controller. Item two, authorize the transfer of Kelly Robb from Nursing Supervisor to Director of Staff Development, Berksheim. Purchasing. Adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute two contracts as a result of an invitation to bid wastewater treatment plant chemicals and supplies for a period of 1 year for the wastewater treatment plant. The two winning bids are JCI Jones Chemicals, Inc. out of Sarasota, Florida. That amount is a unit price of $2.16, and that's a pound. And then the second one is George S. Coyne Chemical out of Croydon, Pennsylvania, and that has both a pound price of $2.54 and a bag price of $273.69. Adult probation. Since we have Brendan here, we don't see you that often. Why don't you take us through the adult probation item?
Certainly, Commissioner.
And introduce yourself and your role.
Good morning, Commissioners. My name is Brendan Harker. I'm the Deputy Chief with Adult Probation. Today, we're asking to sign a resolution amending an existing resolution because we're requesting a project modification on our County Intermediate Punishment Grant. We're not asking for additional dollars. We're just creating a new line item to enhance our Saturday drug testing for our offenders. And so we need to make this adjustment.
Thank you very much. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brendan.
We have one item listed under the commissioners. Adopt a resolution authorizing Brian A. Gottschall, Director of Emergency Services, to electronically execute the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania State Fiscal Year 19 and 20 Radiation Emergency Response Fund Grant Agreement. Item two, a motion authorizing execution of contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator is set forth on the attached listing dated August the 6th, 2019. There are a total of 9 contracts, one with the Area Agency on Aging, one with CareerLink, one with Children and Youth Services, one with Human Resources, one with Information Systems, one with Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities, and one with Parks and Rec. And then a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth in the Controller's Office voucher listing dated August the 6th of 19 for the week ending August the 7th of 19, and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll. Where's that document? So we haven't signed it yet. There we go.
Man, do I miss Mary Jo.
We didn't do this back in the 90s.
Those were the good old days, right?
Emphasis on old. Okay, just bear with us here a moment.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second to the motion.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. That will go to a report of our treasurer, Dennis Adams.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. We have an opening balance today of $220,526,859.17. A balance to clear of $7,950,435.71, leaving us with a balance today of $212,576,423.46.
Very good. And now to our
proper place.
Very good. I'm glad to hear that, especially since you're the treasurer. Hopefully the controller does the same thing. Sandy Graffius, our county controller, with the controller's report.
Boy, it's tough today, isn't it?
It is a tough crowd.
Accounts payable, $5,835,428.86. We had wire transfers of $2,152,610.17. We had a payroll this week, $4,538,807.37. For a grand total of $12,526,846.40.
Thank you very much. There is no budget and operations meeting this afternoon, so we will move to our chief administrative officer, who is sitting in as our chief clerk today. Want to slide? Nothing. Okay, that makes it simple. We'll move to Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. We're just coming off of the annual County Commissioners Association Conference right here in Redding and Berks County at the Doubletree. I think people had an extraordinarily wonderful time. Weather was perfect for the events on Tuesday afternoon. They got to ride the Culbertdale Railroad, either golf or skeet shoot, what have you. Had a really, really good set of meetings. We have moved a lot of our elections reform initiatives onto our platform, one being no excuse absentee ballots, as well as locations or municipalities with less than 100 voters registered should be a mail-in ballot, so we don't have to put people out in New Morgan Borough for a whole day and set up an election system when we really can simply mail about 17 ballots to the people that live in New Morgan. Hopefully the state will pay attention to that coming from CCAP and move forward on those initiatives. One of the very interesting, we had a group on Wednesday morning that was comprised of folks here from our own county on county municipal cooperation. It was Shannon Rossman, our planning director, who covered mergers and consolidations. We have 4 of the 8 merger consolidations of municipalities in the Commonwealth, and also how the comp plans, the joint comprehensive plans, really work here in Berks County. We had Paul Jansen discuss the Center for Excellence in Local Government. As I said, we met with Schuylkill County. It looks like we're going to probably be visiting Lebanon County in the next few weeks as well, and maybe Luzerne County, to further get into the details of how the center works. And last but not least, our youngest group was the Council of Governments, the Mount Penn Preserve, so Lee Olson presented on that as well. So it was well received. We had several comments that said it was one of the best breakout sessions during the event. So glad to hear that, and glad that people in our community step up and help the commissioners when we need it. I'm sure most of our offices, second item, most of our offices have been contacted by folks who are concerned about the future of Epler School, which is out at Van Reed and Lysies Bridge Road, which originally, many, many years ago, Epler's farm extended out beyond where the new Wawa is into the majestic historic farmhouse area that you see along 183. That was all part of the Epler's farm. So we've had several constituents call in and have grave concerns about the future of the school, which is all the way down at the other end, right across from the airport, and the future of that, because Greater Berks Development Fund is clearing the site for development. Contacted Ed Sawyer from the Greater Berks Development Fund. He's willing to at least put aside any efforts to demolish the school if the county comes forward with any sort of a legitimate, viable plan to do something with the school. I know Commissioner Linebach is also involved in this. We looked at, actually I stopped there yesterday because it's built of stone. There's a significant addition to the back of it built from cinder block, but certainly to try to move that school somewhere else and it's comprised of stone would be a real challenge. So Ed Sawyer said he's more than willing to at least consider, if the board is willing to at least explore the options of trying to preserve that one-room schoolhouse from the 1800s. And I would ask respectfully if we can have this added to our agenda for next Thursday's budget ops meeting. I'll try to get more information ahead of time about that. But from what I understand, they've cleared the trees, they've cleared most of whatever else is on that site, and they were going to be demolishing the school within the next 2 weeks. So hopefully they're not going to be demolishing the school if they hear something back from an entity who is willing to do something about the preservation of the school. It has been listed, it has been put out there, and there really have been no takers. One lady in particular called me, Jane Getz, did call the state Museum and Historic Commission. It's not on the historic register for the fact that most of the interior of the school has been taken out. The blackboard's been taken out. All of the amenities of a school were taken out because it was converted into a house. So that's part of the reason, and I said to her, well, certainly because it's not on any kind of register doesn't mean it isn't worth something. And there are things that are on the register that I've seen go by the wayside as well. So it's not, for me, being on historic register, not the be-all, the end-all, but it is important. I think we have about listing on the Berks History Center website, I think there's three or four one-room schoolhouses left in Berks County. So this is one of those four. So if you're interested, we can talk about it in more depth next Thursday.
Thank you. Commissioner Scott.
Thank you. Question for Sandy. Do you know what the balance of our pension fund is now?
No, but I can find out if you'd like to know.
Okay. I know the market's been very volatile.
I don't do that every day.
That might be an understatement.
It's been, it's just interesting to observe. It bears repeating that the, in order for the pension fund to not be burdensome to taxpayers, it has to earn an assumed rate of return of 7.5%. The Wall Street Journal yesterday reported that nationally pension funds have underperformed their assumed rate of return, yielding on average, or the median is something like 6.9%. The average assumed rate of return is 7.25%. Berks County has an assumed rate of return of 7.5%, which is on the high side. If we were to lower it to 7.25, it would require additional additions, payments into the fund to remain actuarially sound. And one of the great conundrums of investing in today's environment, which is highlighted by recent declines in interest rates due to global factors, et cetera, is that bonds are yielding record low rates of return. So if you buy a bond in the United States and you hold it to maturity, and it's a 30-year bond, you might get 3%. If you do that and you have an assumed rate of return, you're below your assumed rate of return in the case of the county by 4.5 percentage points. That's a guaranteed loser that requires significant additions of county taxpayer monies to the county pension fund. Now, given that we don't have all our money in bonds, which is a good thing. We don't have that much of a deficit, but the interesting part is I think we have roughly 25% of our money in long-term bonds or medium-term bonds, and the rate of return on that is 2 to 3%. That means that the rest of the portfolio, the other 75%, has to mathematically earn something in the vicinity of 9% or more to offset that guaranteed low return on the bond portfolio. Where are you going to earn 9% annually in this market in stocks? It's a tough quandary. It's a tough question, and it's unlikely to happen, and we're long overdue for a recession or at least a flattening of returns. And so there's a rocky road on the horizon here when it comes to the performance of pension funds nationally, at the state level, and locally. And I just would observe that that's a real challenge for anybody in the pension management business, and we're no exception. So it'll be interesting to see what happens going forward. I think it was Jeffrey Gundlach, who's the bond guru, yesterday announced that the yield curve involving long and short-term rates portends a recession. He's a pretty accurate guy. So we'll see what happens going forward. It's a fascinating subject, but that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you. Several items here. The upper one-room schoolhouse, Commissioner Barnhart touched on that. I'm also involved at this point. I think all that we have is a commitment, a short-term commitment to hold. And it is not an easy task to move a masonry structure. It can be done. There are moving entities that can move the whole thing, but quite difficult. I was over there 2 days ago, took some pictures. There are actually way more than three one-room schoolhouses. There are a lot of them throughout the county. Many of them have been turned into homes, done very nicely. What makes this one, I think, interesting compared to some that are in really bad shape is that this is a very structurally sound building. The roof is solid, it's tight. The exterior is pretty much as it was, with the exception of the backside. I've not seen how it's tied in, so I don't know the integrity of the back wall, if the back wall's been blown out or if it was just an addition. But there was an article in the paper, and I think the article in the paper spurred people's interest in the school, and we'll see what the options are. I also want to note the CCAP annual conference. It was really great to see Berks County shine. And I will tell you, I heard from commissioners from all across the Commonwealth that were blown away. And it's funny, a lot of them walked downtown, walked from the down to the restaurants, over to the Ugly Oyster, down to the Peanut Bar, and thought, boy, this is an amazing place. I had a couple people say, I had no idea you have so many Latino people in your city. And I said, that's 68% of our population. It was fascinating to get very positive feedback. I also got actually talked to Kevin this morning, positive feedback on the session that Kevin was involved in, along with Paul Jansen, Lee Olson, and Shannon Rossman. I also want to compliment two people in particular. Mary Buer, who left on vacation today, so she's not here, for pretty much a year has been the point of contact between CCAP and the county and doing a lot of the planning. She's done a very good job. And the second person I want to recognize is Christine Sadler. Christine almost single-handedly put together five large gift baskets that are given away as door prizes, and she went out of her way to make sure that they broadly represented businesses here in Berks County. One of the commissioners that got one of the baskets early on came to me Tuesday evening and said, Christian, I just want you to know, we've been, I'm trying to think, he had a Brewster's, a gift certificate, I think they were over, it's a gift. They went to he was at Ugly Oyster. He just could not get over what's here in Berks County, and that's why you do those. Almost all the counties do one or more of those gift baskets to really promote this is what our county is about. And we did that. Oh, I say we. Christine did that. And then Christine and I think Ron helped somewhat on the
Ron K.
gift. And Beth. Kay, the gift that was given, the gift bag. Again, we got rave reviews on the, it was a dry bag. There was a spoon in there from It's a Gift. The gift
It's actually Chester Basil's.
Spoon. I get them all mixed up. There was a lot of stuff. It represented Berks County very, very well. And that's exciting. You always are concerned that something will go wrong, kind of like it did several years ago at another county where there was no water in the hotel.
Oh, yeah, it was. It was brown.
It was brown. Okay. Yeah. No usable water. We didn't have any of those things happen, and the DoubleTree was over the top, and people commented, we can't believe how we're treated by everybody at the DoubleTree. So that was a great thing to see. One of the speakers was a lady by the name of Kelly McDonald. She spoke on diversity, and I be careful here, I don't get myself in trouble, but I thought when she started we were going to get a lecture on political correctness, and it ended up it wasn't that at all. It was one of the best presentations I've heard on how to work together with a diverse team, diverse talents, diverse backgrounds, diverse skills, diverse personalities. And she gave us five takeaways at the end of her presentation, and here are the five. Expect it to feel awkward when working with someone new and different. 2, have conversations, not debates. Use I see it differently. 3, adapt to others and their differences. Give people what they want. And the example she gave is, generally speaking, if you're working with women, they like expansive choices, a large number of choices. If you're working with men, they want a list narrowed down to 3. That's just an example. She gave a lot of examples. 4, talk straight. Use simple language, especially when it's a tough conversation. And 5, use I need your help. Again, I think you were there for that. She was extremely powerful, one of the better speakers I've heard in quite some time. And then the last thing I want to touch on is Friday night, there is a special program taking place, hosted by the Berks Opera Company. It is a program called Die Fledermaus. It is an operetta written by Johann Strauss. It is being presented at St. Ignatius Loyola over on Van Reed Road, Sinking Spring. And I'm in the operetta, and I'm singing. And you'll have to come and find out it's not what you think. I'm in, with Dave Klein and I are making a surprise appearance.
So is this a comedy or an actual opera?
If anybody knows Der Fledermaus, it is a comedy. It is.
I mean that you and Dave Klein are in it.
Oh, it's already a comedy, trust me.
But you just surprised.
Dave Klein and I, we had a rehearsal last night. It's going to be fun. So, and it wasn't my idea. When I was approached, I almost went into complete panic because I have never been asked to remotely get involved with an opera group.
You just blew the secret, though.
What's that?
You just blew the secret.
No, I didn't blow the secret. You'll see the secret. What I can tell you is what's on Facebook. We are, Dave Klein and I, are the party crashers. So we'll leave it at that. But you can, the doors open at 6:45. You can buy tickets at the door. The tickets are $25. And like I said, I was there last night. It's pretty funny. So with that, anything?
If I can just add an additional comment.
Sure.
I certainly appreciate the thanks from you, Commissioner Leinbach. But I do want to clarify. I mean, last year I did the baskets basically by myself, but this year I really need to give the kudos to Kay Lizey and Beverly LeBan.
Great.
Who I provided direction to them and provided assistance, but they were the ones that did all the calling and did the running around, and they certainly wouldn't have been the tremendous gift that they were highlighting the county if it wasn't for Kay and Beverly working very hard. So that's where the credit really is due and owed to.
Which in the long run proves the adage, it takes a team.
Absolutely.
A team is what really makes a difference, which I'm going to throw out one other. The quote that Kelly McDonald ended with is an African proverb. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go farther, go together. And this conference is a great example of that. There's no way any one person from the county could have done this. It was a lot of different people working together, and we're blessed to have those people right here working with us.
I would want to reclarify back to Epper School for a second. In my conversation with Ed Sawyer, there could be a potential option that it remains where it's at as opposed to attempting a very difficult and expensive move. So he said he's willing to explore any options the county may or may not provide. So just to clarify.
Good point. Anything from our row officers? Yes, Sandy.
This coming Wednesday, my audit manager and I are going over to York, Pennsylvania to their prison board meeting. There's going to be a live demonstration on debit cards. And I know both our prothonotary JD and Jim from Clerk of Courts are looking at debit cards instead of doing checks so that we can get rid of some of these cheat problems that we have with those two departments.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? Public comment. Yes, your name and where you're from.
Good morning, Crystal Kowalski from YMSing. I'm here to talk about failure to post collateral imprisonment. And my experiences in trying to follow up on this and have it changed. So my experiences are that I have spoken with you guys. Mm-hmm. I have spoken with the President Judge Parisi. I keep asking people to do things. I keep following up, and I'm getting what I feel like are no answers and to some degree roadblocks. So 2 weeks ago, I asked for help getting the information from the prison, the daily intake numbers, and then Commissioner Leinbach, you asked me to go through the proper channels. I went through the proper channels. I made a right to know request. I got one sheet for one day. Mm-hmm. One can't monitor an ongoing problem with one sheet from one day. But on that one sheet, there were two cases that would have made the newspaper and would have made that spreadsheet. There were two of them in the one day of information I got. And on this piece of paper, it says Berks County Jail System report to the district attorney on this date, Wednesday the 24th. This happens every day to the district attorney. So now what I'm having to do to go through proper channels is submit a right to know request every single day. That is inefficient. I'll do it. It takes me changing a date. But whoever's dealing with this here has to deal with it every day. And it doesn't show good faith in trying to monitor this problem or fix it. So I need your help. Thank you.
How did you make out with the president judge, Crystal? What was the discussion and the...
So I'm not going to say what... I'll tell you what I asked him for. I asked him for these numbers. I asked if it wasn't comfortable giving it to me or the ACLU, that they maybe would go to Mark Gillen's office. I don't have an answer, okay? His daughter works at Mark Gillen's office, so I thought maybe he'd be comfortable doing that, right? Because it's not going to someone, you know, I just thought maybe he'd be comfortable, and I believe that they would look at the information. What you have to do is go through each of these names and search their dockets and make sure there's not a criminal charge associated with it, so that they're purely going to jail on failure to post collateral and a summary offense. Then I asked for a moratorium on their the judge's ability to send these people, because, you know, Judy Schwenk, I think it was, hard to remember everybody now, got, you know, sent a letter and got them training. Do you know when their training is? The end of September.
Got who training?
The training for the judges from the AOPC. So from whenever all this started, which has been going on in perpetuity, their training isn't until the end of September, so people are still going to prison. Like, it doesn't matter. Just stop the process until you fix it.
Wasn't your intent to meet with the president and judge not to provide the daily list, but to find out why people were being sent to jail?
We did. We talked about a lot of things. Okay. I don't feel comfortable saying everything that we talked about because it was a private conversation. But what I asked for was for it to stop until it was taken care of.
But you are comfortable asking us questions in public, but you're not willing to share with us what you discussed.
Well, this is a public forum. That was a private meeting.
Okay. It's fine.
Yeah, the difference is, and I promised you, I'm going to reiterate that request to the president judge. That's why we followed up and asked you to put it in an email so I didn't confuse it.
Right, and I appreciate that. But this is ridiculous. I can't think of another word for it. It's ridiculous that I have to do this.
I understand, but again, the court side is not something we have the management over. That's the convoluted
system. This came from you guys.
Is this from the jail? Right, but we don't. How do I explain the management? You have data coming from the courts.
Yeah, I don't really know the details because this happened must have happened when I was out last week because I wasn't engaged in conversation, so I'm not comfortable.
It's not all under our control.
I know. The other enormous problem with having a week delay on this is these people that are gone to jail can't be taken out. They're already out. Part of wanting to know this is that it can be addressed in real time, and we don't have the information in real time.
But my concern that I expressed to you previously with Crystal with that list, and that what I'm not clear on, is I think that list can be misleading because of detainers and the like that exist from other jurisdictions that are not going to necessarily show up on that list. And that is my concern with just running the person through, you know, the system, that somehow all the reasons why a person may be in jail may not be apparent to you, because I explained to you the process about the reason why you wouldn't want to post bail if you have detainers that are holding you in jail that are not going to be released. A person would not want to post bail in a new case because then they would not get credit for the new case for days spent in jail. So my concern in that list is that the information, the complete history of the circumstances surrounding that person may not be apparent based on that limited information that's on the list.
Okay.
But I need to look at what you got because I was not aware that anything was sent to you, and I want to see that information.
I did double check what I thought was correct with an attorney from the ACLU, and he believed also that was just on a summary offense, failure to post collateral on those two cases. Now, I don't know if he has the ability to see what you're talking about. Thank you.
Thank you.
What's the overarching issue here? I'm just curious. I mean, Yes. Your position, you've raised this several times at several meetings. Is it that this collateral, is this payment for fines?
So failure to post collateral, in my understanding, is they cannot, it's like bail. So they can't put up money. They're being asked to put up money to prove that they're going to show up at a hearing. Now, a lot of times, the hearing that they're posting money to show up at or not being able to is a payment determination hearing. That makes no sense. That makes no sense. But I mean, I don't know how else to say it. I mean, the numbers are there. We are twice as high as York County, which is significantly, they were second runner-up, right? Significantly higher than all the other counties. If this was common practice, we would not be that out of line. There is something wrong. Literally every leader got in the newspaper, said, I do not agree with this, this is wrong. But trying to get anybody to take responsibility and do something about it appears to be impossible.
So our district justices apparently treat these individuals differently than in other counties? Is
yes.
that your position?
Yes.
When, why would that be based on your research? Again, we're not in charge of the judiciary. So why is that? Have you
reached any conclusions? To me, this whole system doesn't make any sense. Do you know what? I mean, I'm sure you do know what happens, right? If they go to jail, they can get $40 towards whatever they owe. That's illogical. Totally illogical, money-wise. You're a money guy. That's illogical. I don't know why they're doing it. I mean, it could be for power. It could be for control. I don't know why they're doing it.
Well, I think it's, you know, I think in some cases, imprisonment is a last resort invoked by a judge who may be frustrated with someone who is a repeat offender, who is judgment-proof, who refuses to obey the law, who, let's say, for example, repeatedly fails to pay his parking tickets, double parks, parks illegally, parks in place when you're supposed to be... the street's supposed to be vacant so you can sweep the streets. And this guy decides, hey, I'm not paying my fines. I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to thumb my nose at the law. There has to be consequences for those people, just as there are consequences for people who fail to pay child support. Those people get jailed sometimes as a last resort, because if they thumb their nose at the law, there has to be consequences to alter their behavior. So I see this as a tool in the judge's toolbox. It may not and probably should not be the first tool employed, but in the end, there have to be consequences for people to modify their behavior. And I personally think that that's something that's entirely appropriate from time to time.
There also has to be equal justice. I will send you the spreadsheet if you would take the time to look at it. I'll send it to you if you would like it. You can look at how many of these cases are in Reading. You can look at the truancy cases. They're in Reading. You can look at most of the parking cases. Now, of course, I mean, parking is more restricted in Reading, so this sort of makes sense. But is justice being evenly distributed?
So should someone who routinely fails to get his or her children to school never face the prospect of imprisonment?
Why don't they at Wilson? Why don't they at Wyomissing? Why don't they at Twin Valley? Is there equal enforcement of the law? Is there?
Well, is there equal numbers of violations in every school district? There may be more truancy cases per capita in the Reading School District than there are in Wilson.
I guess my argument with this whole thing is we start to be comfortable looking at it as just numbers. Oh, there were only 42 cases in the first 3 months of 2019. That's 43 people who went to jail. That's 43 people who had their lives significantly altered, maybe lost their jobs, were traumatized. You have to look at each case as a person.
Well, that's what I believe the judges do.
I don't know how one could explain those numbers. Are we that much more? I mean, does our population break the law that much more?
Twice as much as your county?
I
won't argue that we perhaps should change our statistics in the direction you're suggesting, but I wouldn't rule out imprisonment for people who routinely fail to abide by the truancy laws, the parking laws, anything that results in a fine, and maybe they're poor and this is the only way that they can they can't pay a fine. It doesn't apparently affect them. So what's left for a judge to do to get a mother or father to send his kids to school? Maybe he puts them in jail.
I don't think that makes sense.
Well, then the kids don't go to school then. Is that the solution? No, of course not.
You came up with creative solutions for other things. It's education. Like, figure it out, you know?
I think that's naive in the case of some of these parents.
But we disagree.
Okay. I enjoyed the discussion, Crystal. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just going to weigh in. First of all, I'm not going to speculate on the causes, but there's certain things that I think are absolute reality. One is the statistical anomaly of Berks versus everyone else raises serious questions. You can't ignore statistics. So finding out what is driving them is a valid and legitimate concern. Two, I know for a fact from talking to the district attorney that the district attorney, number one, does see this information in a very timely way. I doubt it's that chart that he's getting.
It goes to him.
But he knows, because I often hear from him, you won't believe what this MDJ just did, and he intervenes. Often it's him along with our public defender, Glenn Welsh, intervening in those cases where there are no other circumstances and it's just flat out a ridiculous decision. The third aspect that is not arguable is anybody that goes into the Berks County Jail becomes a ward of the county and the responsibility of the county taxpayer. And there's a cost associated with that. The cost may be minimal. They may be in for a couple of days and they're out, nothing happens, and then it's minimal. And then you have the Eileen Danino scenario where we didn't do anything wrong, but she died in our Berks County Jail, and you deal with all of the challenges that come with that, the perceived liability. And then finally, I think there is a human responsibility to determine that when you have a truly nonviolent offender, you don't let them off. I've never suggested that because somebody can't pay, there should be no punishment. But we need to look at alternatives to jail. The risk for the county is too great, and when you put somebody in jail for parking tickets or for truancy, as a rule, things don't get better. They get much, much worse because of the issues that come once a person is incarcerated for the first time. The challenge that we have, and I explained to you, I think a couple of times, but we talked last week, is that in Pennsylvania, we have a split environment in county government when it comes to courts and the rest of county government. We have the fiscal responsibility for the courts, but not the administrative responsibility. The courts have the administrative responsibility through the president, judge, and court administration, but they have no fiscal control. In the private sector, there's no business person in the world that would accept that kind of an environment. You couldn't run an organization if you only had administrative or only had fiscal control. But that's the reality that we're in Pennsylvania. I'm frustrated. We've gone through two complete Supreme Court decisions, one in the late 80s, one in the late 90s, ruling that the state legislature and the administration are obligated to fully fund the courts. And not only has it not gone anywhere, it's gone the other direction since the years we've been in office. And that creates a real challenge. So I hopefully that clarifies where I am and why I have an interest in doing what we can do, but it's not as simple as us being in charge of both fiscally and administratively, fixing it. We're not in that position to fix it as simply as that. So, but it's a legitimate, in my opinion, a very legitimate concern. Yes, sir.
My question is, and I'm having a little bit of difficulty in following this, there are 17 MDJs in the county, but either four or five, we may be down to four in the city,
five,
which represents one school district. If you go to the Hamburg area, there's one MDJ representing the entire Hamburg school district. So are we saying that put in jail without collateral, or are we talking bail or collateral?
We're talking bail.
We're talking bail.
When you hear collateral, they couldn't post collateral, they couldn't post bail. So the people that cannot afford bail.
Okay, they could put up collateral.
It's just called something different.
Yeah, it's bail.
So if it's a criminal case or a common plea, like, it's called bail. But in the district justice's case, it's called collateral. But it's still money.
It's still bail.
It's the same thing.
Yes.
It's called it different.
It's bail.
Yes.
And bail, if bail is set at an unreasonable level.
Yes.
You shoplift and stole two packs of gum, and the MDJ sets bail at $6,000.
Right. And that's
real bail. You either need to get a bail bondsman, go to the prison society, or be able to post it yourself. But I mean, the fact of the matter is that no one can tell the MDJ what to set the bail at.
Right.
They can override them, but they can't tell them what to do. The MDJ is an independently elected judicial officer of the court, and they set bail based on what they are presented with at the time that they do it. And I'm not defending them. I'm just trying to figure out, when we talk collateral and we talk bail, bail is what I believe we're talking.
Just got it from
so
bail.
If somebody comes in with five parking tickets, first of all, are they going to have
somebody
a hearing? Are they going to plead right then and there that, yes, I owe it, and at $100 a ticket to make it easy? That's $500 that they need to come up with, or go on a payment plan, which is determined by the MDJ that's going to hold a financial hearing. Now, my problem is that in this country, there's no debtor's prison. So we are not supposed to be putting people in jail who do not have the ability to pay. That is determined holding a financial hearing determination to find out. Someone like me that has a job and they want $500, they know I can pay it. Somebody that's laid off and has five kids and a mortgage, they can't, you know, set $500 on there. They have no ability to pay that. They haven't even had a hearing yet to find out whether those tickets are, you know, that they can be convicted for violating the parking statute. So bail is set by the MDJs. The president judge has every right to tell them we need to be more reasonable with the bail we set, the amount that we set on these type issues. But unless he's going to monitor every single bail issue of 17 MDJs, it's impossible. Now, what happens is they come into the Court of Common Pleas, and you have a what would be an appellate judge for them, which is the trial court judge in the Court of Common Pleas, says bail's ridiculous, I'm lowering the bail. My office handles that, bail will be reduced, and it'll be done. Now, it's difficult for someone that is indigent to go through that process of even getting into the Court of Common Pleas to have that bail reduced. But I'm just trying to figure out, are we saying people are going to jail because bail is set too high?
Yes.
So that's what we're saying.
I mean, no one, if they said, you know, you need to put up $200 today to prove you're going to be in this hearing or go to jail, and you had $200,
you don't have to go to jail. I understand that, yes.
And the hearing that we're talking about, them putting that up, what is a punitive determination here in many cases?
Oh, I know. I've seen that.
It's difficult.
So this goes back to my original comment was, what did the president judge say that he would be able to discuss with the MDJ? So, excuse me. But my point is, you come to us and we tell you what we can do and what we're encouraged to try to do. We hear what you're saying, but we're only a portion of this.
I know.
And it really has to start, and we told you this the other week, it has to start with the courts. And we have to hear what the president judge is going to demand of the MDJ system.
You know, I'm asking from you guys a reasonable way to get this information. I'll do it. I'll get up every morning and send an email. I have been. It's ridiculous. And it doesn't show.
Okay, so, Crystal, I think what you're asking for can be accomplished, but it's an unusual ask because most every other write-to-know request is some static piece of information in time, not every day for the next 365 days I want to report. It's challenging. It's not as easy as saying, could I see Kevin's phone bill for the last year because I want to see what he spent on his phone, as opposed to you're asking for something every day constantly. And I would say that every picture tells a story and everyone has a story as to why they're in jail. I think really drilling down into that would be, you cited two people on a list of 30-some. Be interesting to actually know what the chronological sequence of events that they eventually landed in jail and why, as opposed to just, as you can, simply looking at numbers. You can't really look at numbers and say, that's objectionable because those two people really shouldn't have been in jail. How did they eventually end up there? I can't tell you that unless you sat down and talked to them. Well, okay, so that's only telling you one piece of that whole story. Do you know, did you actually contact them and ask them why? Did you sit in an MDJ courtroom for a couple days and actually see how the process evolves?
I think we should have a board of people that go.
That's really what should happen to see how these things process their way through the system. And I'm not excusing what happens, believe me. I don't think anyone should sit in jail unnecessarily for a summary offense, but there could have been a whole laundry list of things that happened before that, and it's not simply because an MDJ had a bad day. But hopefully it's not, but I'm sure there are other circumstances that drive somebody to a point where, guess what you're going to need to do? You're going to need to spend some time in jail because we've exhausted all the remedies possible, and not everyone does community service, even though you say, the simple solution is, well, let's just give them community service. What if they refuse to do that? You're trying to be humane about it, but at the same token, some people just thumb their nose at authority. They thumb their nose at the system and say, no matter what you do, I'm not going to post collateral, I'm not going to post bail, I'm not going to do this. What are you going to do to me now? So I'm not saying that's all people, but there are people out there who game the system to the point where the system says, we've had enough. Again, that could be very, very small group of people, but until you know the exact sequence of events and exactly why that person ended up in jail, I don't want them in there any more than anyone else. Right. The most expensive part of incarceration is the first day, is the booking procedure, which costs you as a taxpayer $100-some to process somebody who effectively might be out the next morning. So we're never getting that money back.
I know. When you multiply that. We've known for over 5 years collectively that we have a debtor's prison and we have done nothing.
But see, that's what's unfair. We have done nothing as a community.
I'll include myself. All of us have done nothing.
Well, that's a fairer way to put it.
Okay.
But I will. I want to be careful here. I have been meeting regularly with the president judge. I met regularly with the first president judge. Wasn't able to do that with the president judge in between. The constable issue, a number of other areas, I've asked, but I don't have the authority to force anything. It took from the very beginning of this year to get an order from the president judge, which he did within the last two and a half weeks, that the district attorney called for, the sheriff called for, I called for in an article all at the same time, and that was that criminal warrants should not be served by constables. That finally has occurred.
Misdemeanor and felonies, Commissioner.
Yes.
Misdemeanors and felonies.
I used a more general term, but yes. Misdemeanors and felonies. And that has happened. There's nothing I could do. And in reality, there was nothing the sheriff could do. There was nothing the district attorney could do. They pressed and pressed. We were in at least one meeting where we heard them both bring that up. And that's happened. We need to continue collectively to apply pressure. I believe that nationally, you're going to see in the next several years the bail reform dramatically. because there are some serious constitutional questions about equality, and I'm using the wrong term here. People should not be treated differently before the courts based on their financial standing. A decision, and we probably confuse viewers a little bit because we're talking about two different things. Somebody can be sent to jail to serve time for fines owed. That's not the same as somebody being sent to jail to await trial and posting collateral, posting bail. They're two different things. But I think we have to look at that very closely. If somebody is going to jail while waiting for trial, it should be based on risk. Is there risk of violence? Is there a flight risk and potentially a risk to oneself that tends to be a mental health issue? There are tests that other counties, more and more counties are doing this, that they have used to replace bail. And they simply determine you have two people come in, they are accused of committing the same crime under the exact same circumstances. The only thing that's different is one has the financial resources to make bail and one does not. Explain to me why it's right for the one person to go to jail waiting trial while the other person is out on bail. The being out on your own recognizance should be based solely on risk. And I've given this before, but Mesa County, Colorado made that change in 2012 and didn't eliminate all bail, but the vast majority of bail. They went to a certified test, and after 3 years, they looked at the percentage of people that were out on their own recognizance, and they compared it to 2011. Up until 2011, the percentage of people that showed up for their hearing was 80%. After 3 years, and they upped, I think it was by almost 60% of more people were out on their own recognizance. The percentage of people that showed up for their hearing was 80%. It was unchanged because what they looked at wasn't the ability to pay, they looked at the risk. And that's what it should be about. That's easy for me to pontificate here. I have no ability other than the influence of the bully pulpit to influence it. I've done that, and I've done that just now. But I think it fundamentally has to change. Say one last thing about jail, and I've heard this argument, that if you don't have the ultimate tool of jail to hold over somebody's head, then you're not going to get compliance. I'm throwing this out to make a point. Why not put capital punishment over their head? Wouldn't that be the ultimate influence? Most of us would say that's ridiculous. Capital punishment for somebody that stole two pieces of gum and couldn't pay, legitimately couldn't pay their fines, or double parked 20 times and couldn't pay their fines, you would say that's ridiculous. Well, I think it's pretty ridiculous to put somebody in jail for that as well. And I believe you do have to pressure community service. One last thing. We've talked about this, Christine and I and others. There are people, I think it's crazy, that choose to go to jail in lieu of paying the fine.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't be allowed to do that because of
cost. I'm not saying, because of the risk to us, the risk to the taxpayer, I don't disagree. But let's be careful that we don't take an entire group and assume that they're all being screwed over by an unjust system. That there are people that are also, in my opinion, gaming the system. Based on what I've seen, that's not the majority, though. So I think it was Commissioner Barnhart that at the beginning of this meeting highlighted that a short agenda in his prior experience often went long. So we've done that, but I think it was a interesting and worthwhile discussion. Any other public comment?
Motion to adjourn.
Meeting is adjourned.